3, 2, 1. Okay, hey guys, it's Jeff Lafferty. It's the Artcast again. It's the second Artcast. I got a lot of questions about the piece I put up yesterday, the Dracula piece that I did. And I thought, you know, why not make another video and talk a little bit about Dracula, talk about Bela Lugosi, who is kind of a passion for me. A lot of the old movie monster actors I'm really into and, you know, I've been for a long time. So anyway, let's do it. So I guess the first thing I should say is this isn't the first time I drew or painted Dracula. I've done it several times. And I've done it, you know, in a lot more realistic kind of way. Here's one of my earlier drawings I did, which is color pencil on gray paper with white color pencil, white acrylic for the highlights. I like that one a lot. One of my best pieces, I feel like, is probably a Dracula piece, which is this one. This is one of my prints I sell on Etsy and eBay. And it's one of my best sellers. It's definitely up there with the Frankenstein print. And, you know, I can see why. It's a great piece. I mean, I love the girl, especially. I mean, I like Dracula. I like the composition. But the girl, the way I got that glowy look on her hair and her skin and stuff was just like... it made me happy. It's like one of those things that I struggle with, I think, sometimes, is like the skin color of women, and especially where I'm taking like a black and white photo and transferring it into something color. That's hard for me, and I thought that came out really nice. Speaking of eBay, let me throw this in before we get any further. This piece, this new Dracula piece I did, and a couple others are up on eBay right now. This is kind of how I'm trying to fund the comic. I'm trying to figure out a way to make the comic work financially. You know, that's always like an issue when I start trying to do these comics. And it's like, how do I pay the bills? Like I usually pay the bills when I'm not, you know, drawing as many commissions and stuff. So anyway, there's some stuff on eBay. Just letting you guys know in case anybody wants to buy something. I had some questions about the drawing, you know, like, obviously I'm drawing it with a blue color pencil, and the color pencils I use they're called color erase, so they're erasable color pencils, and they have like a really hard lead, and I love the blue, and I really love the Tuscan red, and those are the two I like, and then there's like a black one that's not as good. Well, I mean, there's all the colors, but like, all the other colors I really haven't ever been able to get along with, but I really like the blue and I really like the Tuscan red, and I have some blues right now, so that's why I've been sketching these out in blue, and I'm drawing them loose, you know. I'm just not tightly penciling these sketches, and that's how I like to ink, you know. I like to just get the idea of the thing down and get the parts that need to be in the right spots, like, let's say. So, like, you know, I want the eyes to be even, and I want the facial shape to be there. And I want an idea of, like, what I'm seeing in my head put down. But I don't want to trace over my lines, you know, like, as you can see, like, as I draw. I'm not necessarily, when I'm inking, I'm not necessarily going over the lines, you know. I'm not tracing the actual lines. I'm just inking very loosely and drawing still with the pen, you know. And that's how I like to do, like, these pieces. And by these, I mean, like, these more cartoony, more comic bookish pieces that kind of look a little bit more like my comic book art. These pieces have been kind of like an experiment. And I've noticed, like, some of my portrait techniques bleeding into, like, the comic book technique that I've been using. And it's just been fun, you know, to try sort of different things. I did one of Ghost Rider. I'll put some pieces as I'm talking. But this Ghost Rider one was one of my favorites. This one I already sold. But it was just fun to draw the motorcycle. You know what I mean? And I pulled up a couple pictures of, you know, motorcycles. And I didn't draw them in the same way I draw my portraiture art. You know, I didn't focus on the picture and try to reproduce the picture. I just let it freely influence me, as I was drawing, you know. And by looking at the picture, I was sort of being informed as to like where the parts were on a bike. But then I just let my sort of comic booky style just kind of take over and make it what it is. And it came out looking like that. There's another one. Actually, this one is still up. It's a Wolverine piece. And I'd say it's sort of Frank Miller inspired because of, you know, like the arrows and the samurai sword. You know, Frank Miller always had Wolverine fighting like ninjas. So that was kind of like the thinking there. I didn't really use a photo or anything like that as reference for this piece. So this was more just straight out of my head. But I still see some of the stuff from my portraiture kind of like mingling with my comic book type art. The obvious is like the gray paper and the white color pencil and all that. I start out with a ballpoint, as you guys can see, and I've had all kinds of questions about what the pens I'm using and stuff. I'm just using cheap pens. I haven't really got around to buying some good pens, so I'm just using the ballpoints I get, you know, like Office Max and stuff. Once I start going dark with it, that's all Sharpie. So I use kind of like the fine tip Sharpies, and then I use the big thick ones to kind of lay in bigger blacks, the thicker lines, you know. And I've kind of become partial lately to adding like a thicker outline around the characters and stuff. Which is something, you know, like I used to do that when I did comics way back in the day. And it was almost like something I kind of forgot, you know, and have sort of rediscovered recently. And I really like it. I like the cartooniness of it. I guess that's sort of what I'm going for, is like a mix of like a cartooniness and a more realistic look, you know. And it doesn't always work, but like when it does, I'm just like very happy with it. With this piece, when I got to this, when I fill in the cape, which is coming up here, I filled that in. I used the marker a bit, but then I just got some paint and I filled in like the blacks and also let the paint, you know, drip down. And I was going to do maybe a little less dripping and splattering and all this kind of stuff. But, you know, once I got going, it was just sort of the way it worked. It didn't really drip and splatter in the directions I wanted it to. So I kind of just kept going. And then eventually I got to the point where I was like, yeah, that's it. Stop. Don't do any more. Don't mess it up. And that's where I stopped. That's another question I get a lot of times, even though nobody really asked it on specifically on this video. But it's like, how do you know when you're finished? How do you know when you should stop? And that, I feel like, is something you develop over time. And I really don't have the answer for it, because I feel like a lot of times I will go too far, you know, and go past the point when it was perfect and make it less perfect. But all I can say about that is just trust your gut. When you're happy with it, stop and don't touch it anymore. And that's probably where it should be. The spatter and all that stuff was toothbrush, by the way. It was just spattered in with a toothbrush. I don't know if I filmed any of that or not. And what I've been doing with these pieces, I hit them with airbrush. I just hit them with some black paint. And the reason I've been doing that is because even though I'm drawing on gray paper, this gray paper is actually a lot lighter than the other gray paper I draw like most of my portraits on. That paper is a lot darker. And I think, what was that? What is that called? It's the, it's got a weird name. I forgot. People ask me a million times. I probably need to go and look real quick. See? Okay, so it's called Mind Tintins is what it's called. So it's M-I-T-E-N-N, I don't know, E-S or something like that. And it comes in different colors, and it's sort of a heavier gray paper. And I think the one I use is steel gray. And it's a great gray paper for color pencil and probably charcoal. I don't know. I don't use charcoal much, but that sort of stuff. It's a terrible paper for any kind of wet medium, though. You know, if you're putting paint on it or something like that, or actually ink, it's not a good paper because, you know, when you draw, the ink just soaks in like crazy, and so your lines become big and thick and blocky. And so anyway, because of that, I've switched when I do these more cartoony pieces. I do them on a different kind of gray paper. And this stuff's better, but it's still a little raggy. You know, it doesn't have like a vellum surface or anything like that, but it's definitely better than that, the other stuff. But it's not very gray, you know, it's kind of light. So I just kind of take my airbrush and I darken up parts and stuff. And what I really like about doing it, though, is that, you know, with my airbrush, I can be real specific. And I can spray, you know, the shadow parts a little darker, or like the parts where I'm going to put white back down. I can put those a little darker. And I can actually kind of accentuate the form a little bit with the airbrush, which is really cool. And I don't know if you guys noticed too, but like, I really am kind of conscious about leaving like the blue lines and not being like, okay, I'm going to like ink it and erase out the blue. You know, I like how that looks. I like how that kind of gives the piece like another dimension, like these remnant blue lines. And sometimes even after ink, I'll kind of go back in with my blue pencil and I'll scribble those back in. You can kind of see there's like a real blue outline around his head and stuff. And I like that, you know. And I definitely put that back in after I inked. And of course, when we get down to the end, you know, I come in with the white color pencil. It's just Prismacolor white. I get that question a lot. You know, what kind of white color pencil do I use? It's just Prismacolor. I'm sure any kind of color, you know, white color pencil would work. I think that's the thing I would like to tell people who ask about, you know, supplies and all that kind of stuff. That, you know, ultimately it doesn't matter. You know what I mean? It's like, it's nice to know sort of like what people use, but at the end of the day, it really doesn't matter what you're drawing with, you know, it's the piece that matters. And there's like a million and one techniques, and then there's probably another 20 on top of that. You know what I mean? It's like everybody's got their own style. Everybody's got their own technique, and you're going to find yours. And it's good to experiment with stuff, you know, try this guy's stuff out, try that guy's stuff out, but ultimately try your own stuff out, you know what I mean? Sometimes people will, you know, email me or even send me stuff sometimes, and it'll be like, it'll almost be like a reproduction of my work, you know what I mean? It'll be, especially with the gray paper stuff, you know. And the more realistic portrait stuff, they'll have found a picture and then they'll have reproduced it perfectly and used the same kind of paper, the same color pencils I used, you know, the same Prismacolor, the same white paint. And then they go like, here, look at this, and they're so proud of it. And that's neat that you could pull that off from what I've kind of showed on my videos and stuff like that. But I always kind of feel like, now I want to see you, though. You know, it's like, okay, you've done me, but now you show me you, you know? Show me, like, what you got. And that's not an insult. That's not sort of downgrading their talent or that kind of stuff. What that is advice from me to, like, everybody. If you're trying to figure stuff out and you're watching my videos, you're watching how I do things, or you're watching how other people do things, take that all in, learn, but then constantly push towards your own style, you know, constantly push towards your own thing, because that's what's going to make you unique, you know. I had influences. I obviously was influenced by Drew Struzan and Simon Bisley and Sam Keith and Bernie Wrightson and Frank Frazetta and a million others, you know. Every one of those guys you could look at and say, hey, Jeff, this piece looks kind of like this guy, or that piece looks kind of like this guy, you know what I mean? And I'll, you know, openly admit that I was influenced and am still influenced by those guys. But I always try to, like, make it mine in some way. You know what I mean? Even when I'm following a photo and trying to draw as realistically as I can, I still try to put my own kind of flair into it, my own sort of style, you know? I might be influenced by other people, but I'm trying to be Jeff Lafferty. And that's a good way to be. So, you know, try to be you. Try to be you. I should say something about Bela Lugosi before I run out of time here, because that's one of the things I wanted to talk about, because, you know, the movie monsters are, they're one of my favorite things to paint, you know, and obviously I painted a lot of them, and a lot of it's because of commissions, but even beyond that, it's just because I like painting the stuff that inspired me when I was a kid. You know, that's why I paint a lot of Star Wars stuff too. You know, the old horror movies that I kind of discovered, you know, late at night on, I mean, they used to have these movies on back when I was a kid in the, 80s. And it would be like the late movie. And then they would have another one after that. It'd be like the late movie. And then they'd have the third one. It was like the late movie or something. And so the last one would go off at like 3 o'clock in the morning, and they would show a lot of the classic monster movies, like Frankenstein, the Wolfman, Creature from the Black Lagoon, Dracula, obviously. And that's where I discovered those movies. They were sort of like my first introduction to like horror, but it like eased me in because since they were black and white, and they weren't terrifying. You know, because when you think about it, like the 80s, that was sort of like the time of like terrifying movies, you know. I mean, the real splatterfest type movies were coming out. And some of those I didn't like. They were too scary for me, you know, especially when I was a younger kid. I wasn't a fan of like The Exorcist, you know, or the Amityville Horror, you know. I didn't even like seeing the commercials for those movies when I was little. But Frankenstein and Dracula was just completely intriguing to me as a kid, and I'd sit up late at night by myself watching these things, you know, like all kids did. You'd make a fort by the couch and squall yourself in there with your dog and a flashlight and you know, get creeped out, but not in a totally terrifying kind of way, you know. And I just loved those movies. I remember later on I found a book at the, I guess it was at the library, but it may have been one of those book fairs. And it was kind of like the history of Universal Monsters or something like that, you know. And it was just a book about how they made the movie, some of the special effects they did. And it had a whole bunch of pictures of, like, you know, Bela Lugosi, Lon Chaney, Boris Karloff. And it was really interesting, and it was awesome. And they kind of had projects in there that you could do. And I remember one of them was a mummy hand. You could make a mummy hand. And they got this leather glove. I mean, this is how they told you how to do it. But you got this leather glove, and then I think you glued cornmeal to it. So you kind of like put glue all over it, and then you rolled it in cornmeal, and then you wrap some bandages here and there, and I think you stuffed it with like newspaper too, so that, you know, it would be like this hand that lays on your desk. And of course, like a leather glove, you know, it takes the wrinkles of your knuckles and all that kind of stuff. And I remember my dad used to just always be like, throw that thing away, it's disgusting. You know, it looks too real. But I remember that, and they showed you how to make kind of like a paper mache you know, taller brow of Frankenstein with the bolts in the head and all that kind of stuff. And just fun stuff, awesome stuff, you know, awesome projects for a kid to do on his summer vacation back in the 80s. And then there was also the famous Monsters of Filmland magazine that came out on the racks around the time when I was buying the great comics that I'm always talking about on this show, you know, like the Spirit magazine, the Savage Sword of Conan, you know, Mad magazine, Heavy Metal, Epic Illustrated. All that stuff was on the stands like when I was a kid, and you'd pick them up at the corner store, and, you know, Famous Monsters of Filmland was right in there with them. And it just fueled my addiction to all that nerdy stuff. And I still have it. I still, you know, go on these internet binges at night looking up stuff about these different guys. And Bela Lugosi's like, you know, one of my favorites. I mean, he always felt like he was typecast as Dracula, as, you know, many of these guys do once they play a role like that. And if he felt like it hurt his career as he went on, because he was always sort of like, you know, Dracula to everybody. And a lot of guys say that, you know, it's like Adam West said that, you know, obviously Batman, and George Reeves, the first Superman, I know, you know, said that and ended up killing himself. And I think it's true, but I also think it's kind of like, you know, when you play a role like that, that's like so big, you know, even if it's not a super successful movie, I mean, you can look at it like it hurts your career, but it also kind of like makes your career in a way, you know, because you're always Dracula after that. I mean, it's like Patrick Stewart is always, you know, Picard, you know. If he wouldn't have been that, I don't know that I'd even know who Patrick Stewart is, you know. But I do know that, you know, like he had a tougher time in his later life. I do know that he was addicted to heroin. I think it was like a medical kind of addiction where he had something wrong with him and then he got addicted to it. And then, you know, that plagued him through most of his life. But I don't know, there's some really good books. There was one, and I should probably look it up. But it was wrote by this kid who, or actually he was just in it. I think somebody else wrote it, but he told a lot of these stories. But this kid, I just went and found it. So it's called Dreams and Nightmares. And it's actually by this guy named Gary D. Rhodes. There's a couple chapters in here about this guy named Dick Sheffield, which is really, I mean, to me, like just these make this book worthwhile to get, because like these kids, you know, almost on a lark, they decide that they're going to call up, you know, Bela Lugosi because they found his phone number in the phone book, and they give him a call, and Bela Lugosi like basically tells them, come on over. And so they do, and they talk about him serving them. If I remember right, it's been a while since I read this book, but I think he dresses up in a tuxedo and then serves them, I think, like toast and something else, tea or something. And he lives in a like a small house, and I believe he's divorced by this time. And these kids become like Bela Lugosi's friend and sort of cohort on all sorts of adventures. It's just some really cool stories. And I don't know, I have a whole bunch of books around here that are probably worth mentioning, but that's one that kind of sticks out in my mind. And then, of course, there's like the Ed Wood movies that he was in towards the end of his life. Glenda and Plan 9 from Outer Space, which I guess, yeah, that was actually filmed before they filmed that movie, and then they kind of put that footage in there. That was actually filmed for another movie. There's like a little scene. Or Bela Lugosi as Dracula is walking through a graveyard, and I think they actually were filming that for a different movie. And then Ed Wood like cut that into Plan 9 after Bela died. I believe that's how it worked. I'm sure there's probably somebody out there that would correct me, but I don't know. I'm just a huge fan. Like he acted like his whole life, and maybe he felt like he, you know, should have been more famous or should have had a better career, and you know, it sucks to kind of die broke, but man, it's like I almost feel like that's like the creative life we're all sort of headed for, you know. There's very few like John Grishams or Todd McFarlane's and Steven Spielberg's and stuff like that. There's like way more of like us that just, you know, do creative stuff our whole lives, and then maybe we get known for something, maybe we don't. We kind of just die in obscurity, but at least we lived the life and tried to create the art that we wanted to, you know. But anyway, guys, thanks for watching. I hope you guys enjoyed the video. And there's my airbrush. Always has to get in, steal my thunder. Anyway, yeah, like I said, thanks for watching. Don't forget about those pieces on eBay if you're interested in buying some art. And I've been listing some prints and all that kind of stuff. You can check those out there, too. Patreon also, if you guys want to just, you know, support the videos and all that kind of stuff. And I'll see you next time.